rainy morning. That's why participants are entering very slowly. Well, on behalf of KSTA and Seshadripuram College, I welcome you all to this webinar. My friend Mr. Shantanu Das, Professor of Biotechnology, has joined in organizing this program. I welcome resource expert and a very good friend of mine, Dr. Uday Shankar Puranik sir, and Dr. Gajendra Deshpande, and our Honorable Chairman, Professor S.I.Appan, and all the participants to this webinar. Dr. Uday Shankar Puranik will be speaking on practitioner's perspective, cybersecurity, a practitioner's perspective. Then Dr. Gajendra Deshpande will be speaking on cybersecurity, technologies, and academic opportunities. Before going to technical session, let me briefly tell about KSTA. Some of you know about KSTA, and many of you may not know. We have been organizing such webinars during the last 1 or 2 months, and my friend Dr. Shantanu has been helping us in organizing these type of webinars. KSTA was started in the year 2005 under the chairmanship of Padma Vibhushan, Professor U.R. Rao, who was the chairman of ISRO. Under his leadership, KSTA grew from 2005 to 2017. And after his sad demise, another great scientist, Dr. S.K. Shukumar, Padma Shri awardee, and former director of U.R. Rao Satellite Center, guided us for 1.5 years. And now, another great agriculture scientist and former director general of ICR and secretary Department of Agriculture Education and Research, Professor S.I.Appan sir, is guiding us in organizing programs. And our member secretary was Dr. H. Vannegowda, who guided us for nearly 15 years. And last month end, he retired from his position. KSTA has been organizing many programs across the state. I am very proud to say that KSTA has covered the entire educational pyramid, right from high school level to university level. Offline, we have conducted many programs for the last 15 years. We have covered all the districts of the state, 30 districts of the state we have covered with our programs. And webinars, well, due to COVID, we have to go for online webinars. And this is the fifth webinar that we have organized. Earlier to this, we had a webinar on IPR, intellectual property rights. We have got overwhelming response from across the state for our webinars too. As you know, because of COVID, personal hygiene is very important. Because of this pandemic, there is a threat to cybersecurity as well. We have to maintain our cyber hygiene as well. As they say, COVID requires warriors, and for cybersecurity also, we require cyber warriors. Only then these cyber attacks could be overcome with good technological effort. With these few words, let me request our chairman to give his keynote address.
Good morning, everybody. Sure, you know, we are all here to experts this morning. Once again, greetings from the Karnataka Science and Technology Academy. I'd like to thank the colleagues from the Seshadripuram College, Dr. Shantanu Das and others. And special thanks to our expert this morning, Dr. Uday Shankar Puranik from the McKinsey, and Dr. Gajendra Deshpande from the Gokhale Institute of Technology. I'd like to thank my colleagues at the KSTA, Dr. A.M. Ramesh, the CEO, and Mr. Umesh, who is our expert, you know, handling all this. So friends, we look forward to an exciting 2 hours in the next, before lunch. And we are grateful to all of you for having joined us. I won't need to say much when we have experts amidst us, but we must recapitulate a few points here. Now, online, whatever we are talking of, it's become almost a way of life in India. The last 3 months, each one of us is increasingly getting into this mode. So virtually from cradle to grave, we are on to this mode of communication. So any economic activity that we are taking, for talking of today, whether it's education, industry, the agriculture, communication, transportation, services, I can go on. Aadhaar card, ID, in every sense. And then similarly, it goes to medicine, tourism, and air travel, banking, railways, you take anything, security, defense, it's in this mode. So now today we are talking of the IT to IoT, Internet of Things. And we are all wedded to it virtually. There is almost no way that we can escape or we can be without this technology. So at this time, what is happening is we are being increasingly being exposed to an explosion of software, devices, gadgets, and so on. So that requires a management, that requires policy, that requires governance, that requires laws. So it builds up one after the other. And in this context, standard operating procedures, SOPs, and then guidelines and so on. At the same time, you would appreciate friends who are among the audience today. We are expecting nearly 200 of them. Many are joining now. We also have multiplicity of players. That's very important. It could be public, it could be corporate, it private, the organizations, different organizations, vendors, it goes on. So on one hand, the issues, on the other hand, the players. And just yesterday, I was reading in the newspaper, in Bangalore alone, our experts might bear me out as we go along. In this lockdown period, there have been more than 2,000 fraud cases. It could be debit credit cards, it could be job frauds, it could be card skimming, gifts, loan offers, asking for advance fees, it goes on and on. So without a security, awareness, security consciousness, security preparedness, getting into any of this cyber mode will be at our own risks. Personal information, sensitive information, intellectual property, all that we keep talking of. So we are all at risk at the institutional level, at the individual levels. So that's why this becomes very contextual. Today's webinar, today's talks become very contextual. And I'm sure our colleagues would bring before us a number of processes, the kind of practices, techniques to protect ourselves, our devices, our programs, our data from any of these attacks and damages. So there could be in different forms, the physical security, it could be information, cognitive, the social dimensions. So I'm sure all of them would be brought before you. And we are now looking at maybe this is an awareness session. What we expect is our audience, after they have been kind of sensitized, would come back in greater numbers, larger numbers, to ask questions not only in today's session, but further also with the Karnataka Science and Technology Academy, to the Sheshadripuram College, and two of our experts today, Mr. Puranik and Mr. Deshpande. So we are here to continuously interact with you. And please don't think that this one-off session, it doesn't end up with just the certificates. It's a process that we would like to keep it live. With these words, once again, thanking all of you, we welcome to an exciting two sessions this morning. Thank you very much. Dr. Puranik.
Oh. Now let me have the privilege of introducing my good friend Dr. Uday Shankar Puranik. As you might have seen the brochure, Dr. Puranik has 3 PhDs from different countries. One from University of London, then from US University of Wisconsin and National University of Singapore. He is a very accomplished technologist that we have in the state and in the country. We are very proud of you, sir. Dr. Puranik has visited many countries across the world. I am sure you know that there are 195 countries in the world. Dr. Puranik has visited 150 countries across the globe. I am sure in another few years, you will complete another 46 and become cover his entire globe. Well, he has done many good things for Canada also. As you may have seen in the ATMs, there are three languages, one Hindi, English and Kannada. Kannada software was developed by Dr. Puranik, and with his own money and effort he has developed. We should all appreciate his zeal to help Kannada in Karnataka. He has written a book in artificial intelligence in Kannada, which has won an award from Karnataka Science and Technology Academy in the last in 2019. With this, his accomplishments are very many, and with this short time, I won't be able to tell everything. With these few words, I request Dr. Puranik to start his session. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Ramesh, sir. Good morning, everybody. And at the outset, I'd like to thank you all for joining this webinar. And today, we are having two sessions. I'll be generally talking about cybersecurity from a person who is actually working in the industry. It's a practitioner perspective. And my friend and Gajendra Deshpande will be talking about the way from the technology perspective, and also what the academic opportunities are available in this field. And as mentioned in the initial remarks by our president, sir, this is more of an awareness session. It doesn't actually aim to make you an expert in any of this field, but it gives you a holistic view of what is happening around the world, and what is that we can do as a citizen, what is that we can do as a student, and what is that we can try to do as a career aspirant in this particular field. So with that, I'll be starting my presentation. I hope all of you are able to see that. Anybody having issues in seeing it? So in the agenda, I'll be talking about the three things. One is cyber threats, and what are the opportunities we have, and we can conclude with a question and answer session. So when we talk about cyber threats, as our presenters have mentioned earlier, there's a lot of media coverage on general cyber incidents, like somebody hacked an email, somebody misused a credit card or a debit card, somebody transferred some money illegally, and this kind of incidents would generally get reported to the local cyber police, and through them to the media people, and they in turn try to create awareness in common people on what this type of incidents are happening. And one of the most abused word as far as reporting in local media is concerned is hacking. Anything and everything comes under hacking to them, and that's actually an embarrassment when you look at it from the kind of work being done within India in the field of cybersecurity itself. So there are three components in the cyber industry. One is what we talk about cybersecurity, and the second is threat detection, and third is cyber forensics and investigations. So let's try to understand today what primarily are these cyber threats and why they're important. A couple of quick facts here. We lose almost $6 trillion every year due to cyber crime. And we spend about 25,000 crore dollars every year on cybersecurity. And Indians are also losing a lot of money. In the 1 year, we have lost about 1,200 crores to the cyber criminals who have, convinced us and taken away our money. From the job perspective, currently there are about 50 lakh job vacancies across the world. And as we are talking today, the numbers of cyber incidents are increasing every day, and currently it is around 7,000 crore cyber incidents every day. We are talking about 130 countries. So that's the kind of growth that is happening in the cyber world as well. And let us see who are these people who are actually contributing to this. Main issue what we are finding is a good amount of contribution is by people within an organization. They may be unhappy with the organization, or they may be kind of influenced by some monetary gain by supporting some criminals outside, or they may be threatened to cooperate with the external criminals. So multiple factors there, but still it's insider hand is very visible in many of these incidents, and this has been growing at a breathtaking rate of 320% in the past 3 years. And cost of each insider breach, I'm not talking about a document or information here, we're just talking about a breach, a successful cyber attack, is about 7 crores. And we talk about losing data, each breach is costing us 32 crores. And if you look at 2019 as a year, there have been almost 850 crore records that have been stolen. So third component, which is not often spoken in the media, probably because of lack of awareness, is cyber terrorism. I'll explain as we go through the presentation. The cyber terror attacks, so each one of them are costing us today around 1,900 crores. And we are very, very active today. And let us see where all they're actually trying to create problems for us. So what we currently see here is who are these people who are actually creating all these problems? Earlier, it was people who were just doing for the sake of it. Maybe they thought they're able to break into a secure network and achieve some satisfaction out of it. It was more recreational. Later on came the criminals who actually wanted to make use of this technology for criminal activities. They could be drug peddlers, they could be terrorists, they could be extortionists, they could be people who are willing to do any crime for the sake of getting some money. Money is the motivator there. Then people started getting into hacking. This is primarily trying to deface sites, trying to break into networks, trying to steal information, harass people and all this. But the trend now is organized crime and state-sponsored. Organized crime is where you have cyber experts working in this crime. They're pretty experienced as well. So they come up with a lot of innovative solutions on how to create cyber crime. And state-sponsored is primarily what I mentioned as cyber terrorists. Just as we have terrorist groups sponsored by some countries or protected by them, we have a cyber terrorist also sponsored by different countries, and they're also protected by them and funded very liberally, because all these attacks, even though we talk of attempts, they take quite a lot of resources and quite a lot of planning activity to be done, and it all requires a lot of money. So depending on what the objective of the attack is, a lot of finance is provided by state sponsoring countries, and we do have a couple of them as our friendly neighbors. So that's all the more reason for us to be on more alert in the coming days. Most targeted industries, not necessarily in that order, because we keep finding this order keeps changing almost every week or every day due to the COVID situation, where all the prime focus is on containing the pandemic. So one of the most targeted industries is healthcare. And I've still not come across a hospital or an institution in Karnataka which says, I'm having a very secure system against any kind of a cyber threat. So either we're taking it for granted, or we are not actually working with the kind of importance we should be able to give it. Second is where we have finance and insurance. So what you could have probably heard is people losing some money because somebody called them and duped them, or somebody misused their credit card or debit card. but the current target is on enterprise and wire transfers. And as an enterprise, the entire banking network, which includes ATM, phone banking, web banking, and also retail banking. And wire transfer is across bank networks. And one of the popular wire transfer mechanisms is SWIFT. So these are being targeted because it's much easier to get rich very quickly and also get away even before people come to know. Education is one more area where a lot of cyber attacks are happening. Students are unfortunately are the victims, and also in a way also they're also helping the cyber crime to happen also. I will explain what is the difference there. And government is again a favorite target for them, and retail, primarily point of sales if you're looking at offline retail, and online if you're looking at kind of e-commerce kind of solution. Manufacturing energy, again, a very soft target for the cyber terrorists. And media and entertainment, you might all be aware, a lot of movies are released even before they're actually released in the theaters. And we also find a lot of popular television serials also being released on the web. And these kind of things are happening more often. Transportation, yes, there's a lot of incidents happen, but due to the confidentiality of the nature, I'm not going into every incident in this particular talk, but I'll be highlighting some of the generally known incidents and what is that means to all of us. So the list of industry is not limited to this eight. It actually covers practically every activity what we are involved in. And one thing I'd like to highlight here, cyber attack, the perception is we should be connected to internet, only then this kind of things can happen. And where our systems are not actually connected to internet, we don't have to worry. No, that's no longer true. Even if you're not connected to internet, you can still be facing cyber attack. So we'll go by case and see what is happening. So one of the things what we generally comes to our mind is when we talk of cyber attack, it could be email based, or could be trying to attack our system, or it could be something on the mobile, or it could be debit or credit card fraud, or it could be even somebody trying to access or use our wireless network. But is that all? Is that all the question today? No, it's not. If you look at it, the state actors have disrupted electrical distribution and electrical generation at their will. They even stopped railways from functioning. They have stopped drinking water supply and irrigation water supply. They have actually created a havoc with many banks. And other things what they are also doing is hospitals, as I said, is again a very soft target for them. Industries, particularly petrochemical industries, hazardous chemical industries. And you may be surprised, even food industries have been targeted by these people. And schools and colleges and universities again are a favorite target. Airports are again a target for them. And the same way when it comes to shipping lines, ports, and any other form of transport, these people are trying to target and disturb the whole activity. Now here I'm actually showing you one slide because on this particular WebEx, I'm not able to open the YouTube, but I will try to switch the slides and show you what's happening. So what you see here is a CT scan of a person, and what they try to do in this cyber attack is they've altered the CT scan. Here they've actually included lung cancer nodes in the second slide, almost 400 of them, and try to show that this patient is highly infected and really requires very critical care. Whereas the CT scan on the before part of it shows is pretty healthy and probably doesn't really require that kind of a treatment. Now you can either insert this kind of nodes and make it appear it's a very critical case, or you can also remove these nodes. Even if it's a cancer patient, you can remove and alter the CT scan and show he's very healthy. Now, let's go back to my argument. We said cyber attack doesn't have to happen only if internet is there. Obviously, a CT scan machine is not connected to internet anywhere, but it's connected to computers and network, and this kind of people try to get into it and alter CT scan images. And they're also trying to do the same with MRI scans, X-rays, and this kind of activities. And it's pretty dangerous because it misleads the doctors, and that's where the problem of a wrong diagnosis or wrong treatment can also happen, leading to many other complications. So this is one of the challenges what we face. Next one is where they're trying to, you know, take control of the pacemaker. Like you're all aware, pacemaker is an implant which has been used for some of the cardiac patients, and one of the prime requirements is to regulate the heartbeat. Whenever the heartbeat goes erratic, the pacemaker steps in and try to normalize the whole thing. Now, what do these people do is remotely they try to reset the pacemaker settings, because pacemaker is configured for each patient requirement. There's a level at which the pacemaker should start working and the level where it should stop. Now, when I talk about a heartbeat, it's programmed accordingly. And after implementation, nobody can actually change that program. But you can actually reset it to factory settings. So what happens when you reset it to factory settings is, even when the person is having a situation where pacemaker has to help him, it does not help him at all. And he may actually collapse, and in some cases may also die. So that's a situation is one of the problems that are being created, and nobody would know that because nobody is near the person. Nobody is actually trying to physically alter anything within the pacemaker, but these kind of attacks are also happening, particularly targeting some of the high net worth individuals or celebrities who are prime target of this kind of cyber criminals or cyber organizations. So it's a question like, you pay me money or I can probably create a situation where your health deterioration can happen. Worst case, you may also die. So these kind of things, there are repeatedly playing around, even with ICU instruments, even with our instruments used in operation theater. So this is one of the challenging things, because they are not doing it in a regular way, and it's very difficult to find out who did it. You may find out who is the insider who actually kind of collaborated with them, but you can't actually find out who actually did this. So they're very careful in masking their footprints and also, getting away as quickly as possible from whatever they've been doing it. So this is one of the challenges what we have. And we'll be coming to one of the commonly used device, that's our cell phone or smartphone. Often we use our smartphone for selfies or taking videos, making calls, sending SMS. But the smartphone also have a lot of sensors along with it. And these sensors can actually be used by a person who can remotely control the phone and actually do all that we are trying to do. For example, he can know where we are, with whom we are, and also take our photograph or video without our consent, listen to our calls and even record those calls, and even access whatever documents and photographs what we have saved in our smartphone and copy it without our knowledge. Now, these are something which can be tracked, and somebody behind this kind of activities can be actually brought to book. But the problem is, when somebody spoofs the phone number and makes a call to, let us say, a illegal organization or a terrorist organization. For example, if my phone is compromised and somebody makes a call using my phone number, let us say to a terrorist group, and when the investigation starts, people come back and find out that the call is made by my phone number, I'm not even aware of that. And the call records show that actually the number has been used. So this is where we have to be very careful when it comes to sharing our phone number on social media. Often I find even some of my friends on Facebook sharing their phone number in public. Please avoid that. Even one phone number can actually allow this kind of activities and also compromise your Facebook or social media accounts very quickly. So please don't share your phone numbers, don't share your personal photographs in public. If you really want to do that, do it with your select group of friends, or you can even SMS them or send them on the messenger, or try to keep it as secure as possible. So I'll be showing the other way they abuse this particular facility. This is what we call as a side channel attack. What you find here is two people are talking, but what has happened is because the voice is low, the lady has put the call on loudspeaker, the loudspeaker in the phone. So what happens in this condition is the vibration from the loudspeaker is picked up by what we call as an accelerometer, which is one of the sensors which is inbuilt in our smartphone. And these vibrations are picked up by the person who actually want to know what the two people are talking. So we actually call this as a side channel attack. And in this situation, what happens is, how does this happen? How do you actually even get this information? Maybe a question. Very simple, we use smartphone for a lot of browsing, installing a lot of apps, and we give a lot of permissions without even really looking whether these permissions are required. I'd like to share my own experience here. It's a very well-known bus travel agency in Karnataka. They also developed an app, and when I thought I can install the app and book my tickets, the app during installation asked whether I can give permission to access my photographs, can access my folders, and the moment I said no, it did not install. Logically speaking, why it should require access to my photographs or photo, you know, any folders? It may ask for SMS access because they may be able to send some SMS confirmation on the ticket being confirmed, or the, you know, reminder when the bus service is supposed to start, or in case there's a delay also, they may be able to remind to us. Phone, I can understand if they're looking at a QR code kind of a thing, or you're sending a e-ticket, probably the camera could be useful. But other things are not really required. Why do you want my friend list? Why do you want folders? Why do you want photographs? Not really required at all. So you've got to ask at every point, however reputed the organization is, please ask questions even before you install any app on your phone. That's one of the things. And second thing is, please download only from trusted sites. Don't download it from unknown sites or wherever you find it's very easy to download it. One of the situations created now is all of you could be aware about our Arogya Setu application, which is developed by Government of India. And crores of people are using it within the country as one of the tracing tool for the fight against COVID-19. Seeing at the popularity of this application, Pakistan has developed an almost similar application, and it is sending by SMS and email links to different people saying, please download Arogya Setu. It's very easy to download it here. People do it because everything looks similar, but the problem is when you try to download it, you're going to a Pakistan website. You're not actually going to any Google store. And if you don't observe that, then you're downloading a spy app on your phone, and that may create all these problems, what I explained earlier. So please don't entertain any unknown links or emails which ask you to download something from somewhere. And often we find people doing it very innocently. So please try to avoid that kind of situation. That's very important. Next thing is, wherever you already downloaded applications, please check how many of them you're actually using it. And wherever you find you are not actually using some of the applications, please disable them. If you're not using them for 1 month or 2 months, then obviously you're not going to
to use it immediately, enable them. So this is one of the common mistakes what we do when we use our phones. And all these things I mentioned, I'll be going back into each one of them. We are at start of monsoon here, but unfortunately from a cyber's perspective, we are in cyber winter. So what is the cyber winter? You can see that there's a signage outside one of the stores, which says due to computer network issues, we are not able to open up a store, and sorry for that. So what happens here is, as I mentioned earlier, the cyber terrorists will start taking over different systems. They can disrupt our electrical supply. You get up one day in the morning and you find there's no power, there's no water, and your phone is not working, television is not working, and you start wondering what is happening, and go out and you find a lot of people are facing the same problem. You try to go to the ATM and see if you can draw money, ATM is not working, and you find metro is not working, airport is not working, trains have stopped somewhere because signal systems are down. It's almost like the entire city or the region has come to a standstill. Now, this is not a hypothetical situation at all. This has happened. This is continuing to happen in many places of the world. So this is a very serious thing. Very recently, they tried to shut down water supply and electricity in Israel. And they've been doing this on and off in different countries as well. So the prime target here is to derail an economy, create panic in people, and kind of make them lose confidence in the government ability to protect them. It's not easy because for some of you who are very well conversant with the electrical production and distribution, if the grid failure happens or if there's a production issue of electricity, it's not easy to revive it so quickly back and provide electricity again to all the people. It takes sometimes even weeks together of effort. And just imagine without electricity, what all can happen? There can be a lot of problems in healthcare, there can be problems in industry, there can be many areas where we are indirectly affected. So this is a kind of having a winter kind of a situation where people are stuck within their home and nothing is actually working. Only thing is not a war or a nuclear destruction where everything has been destroyed, everything is there, but you're unable to use it. And one of the examples of this kind of a situation where they demonstrated very publicly was in a European country. It was the capital of the European country. For 12 hours, they held their capital city to ransom. No power, no electricity, no phone, no television, nothing worked in the government, and practically nothing. The life came to standstill for almost 12 hours, and later on they allowed everything to start coming back. That was like a demonstration of their capability, saying that we can do whatever we want, whenever we want, now go ahead and save yourselves. That's one of the conditions there. And next thing is, there's a question asked, what happens in education, why there's soft target? Now, education, if you look at it, one of the things is the students, whenever you enroll them, you're taking a lot of their personal data details, their documents, and you're completing the process of admission. And while they're at the institution, all their academic details are also saved within the institution. It could be a college, school, or even a university level. Now, unfortunately, even the some of the biggest universities in United States have been compromised by repeated cyber attacks, and a lot of this information of students and faculty have been sold. Now, when you lose this kind of identity information, it is practically possible or technically possible to create a virtual identity of anybody and misuse that identity for any kind of a cyber crime. So it's not enough if you have a very good software within your college, or you have a very secure wireless network, and you are allowing only students to use it, or you are banning students from using. Now, this is likely to stop this kind of whole large scale attacks. And particularly for institutions which are into research, they're again a soft target because repeatedly they've been targeted in this kind of activities. And a lot of research information is also stolen in this process. And faculty who have tried to expose what is being happened or being kind of threatened and try to be silenced. So it's a very difficult situation everywhere. And though I'm not actually allowed to reveal names of all the universities and institutions here, it's a serious concern. But I also mentioned in a way students also contribute to this because students, we have found that whenever a university has provided a network or systems or wireless access to them, not always they use it for the education purpose. Sometimes they get carried away and try to use it for personal use or entertainment. And unknowingly, they kind of allow this kind of cyber elements to enter into the network and try to remotely control the network and get whatever details they want. So we got to educate our students on hygiene as far as cyber security is concerned. And if at all there's a compromised mobile phone, how do we know? It's very easy. Please go back and see which are the active apps which are running in the background. And have you really permitted them to run in the background? That's one of the things. And second thing, look at the usage data on day-to-day basis. You can't actually find an exploit software in your mobile phone. It requires a little bit of technical skills, but you can still find out if there's been a kind of a increase in data, even when you have not actually used it so much. So please look for some telltale signs, and wherever you find your system is slowing down or you're facing repeated issues of rebooting of the network or call voice kind of echoing. Voice calls are echoing and the other person says she's also able to hear somebody else on your phone call. These are some of the signs to look out. The list is pretty exhaustive, but in the interest of the time, I'm just trying to show some of the general things which you can look out eye and you. And other telltale sign is look at the battery usage. If your battery once charged was coming for, let's say, 12 hours or 10 hours with a normal usage, and suddenly you're finding it's dropping down to 8 hours or 6 hours, one, it could be a problem with the battery, or it could be somebody using your phone and that's actually draining your battery. So you can look at this kind of situations as well. Retail, point of sales, we find it's a very common in most of the retail shops also. But one of the things as a precaution we got to take is please insist on using the credit card or debit card in front of you. Do not give it to somebody and sit away from the machine. Whether it's petrol bank or whether it's shop or a mall or theater or anywhere, please use the card, insist on using that card in front of you only. Otherwise, don't allow it. That's a very hygienic or a discipline we got to bring in. Online frauds, I'd just like to take 1 minute on that. How does this happen? So what they do here is they don't use the computer, they use the monitor drivers to kind of convince us when we have been misled into a wrong site. Let's assume I've logged into SBI bank website. I find the SBI logo there and I find the login screen. I look, everything is nice. But when I'm typing my login credentials, I'm supposed to enter my bank account, right? But I don't find the same SBI bank account opening. It will be some other site which looks like SBI, but which is not SBI. It may be like, it may be saying that SB J or SBK or something like that, but it looks like a banking site. It looks all the same. So what are we thought? We have thought that look, you have to look at a lock mark at the browser, and if the lock is actually there, that means it's a secure site. Otherwise, it's an unsecure site. and you look at HTTPS, and then it's probably more secure. These are some of the common things we have thought. So how does the people cheat is, they create a template, and for us to believe it's a secure site, they use the monitor drivers and create that icon, even on the, you know, the fake site. And it creates a feeling that this is a secure site and we continue with our transaction. And this also happens in public places, particularly where you find free internet available or free Wi-Fi being available for common people. We are kind of tempted because it's free and we want to do a 2 minutes or 3 minutes use of that internet. You can do it, but don't do it for using your banking transactions or buying anything online. Be careful of that because most of the time it's an unsecured network and we may be kind of, you know, compromising our device on that. And third thing, don't get into this habit of visiting every link on the website. For example, when I'm shopping online, I also sometimes get some advertisements there that says this product is available at a nominal price. In the next 1 hour, you buy it, you go and get it. So don't get tempted and be misled out of the trusted site into some other fake site and you lose money there. And the third thing one of the other things which I would like to highlight here is even though we are using our system in a secure network, let us say in a coffee shop or a big hotel, there are people other than us in that particular coffee shop or hotel. And one of them would be kind of using the same tactics to show us the dummy or the fake login screen of that coffee shop. And once we log in, he takes over. He takes over our system. He takes away our information. And worst case, if we thought he's a cyber terrorist, then he crashes our system. So our system and data is unusable. We call it as destructive cyber attacks or things being done to destroy data and systems. So it's not just data and system. They can, they've already done it with, even at nuclear reactors. They've done it with hotels. They've been doing it with water supply. And the whole objective is to crash the whole thing. And one of the serious incidents which was found just in time was when they tried to disturb a production of a very hazardous chemical in a European country. And if at all they succeeded with manipulating the boiler temperature, it would have been a serious accident and causing a lot of deaths and injuries in the neighborhood. So they go to any extent to these kind of things. So we got to be all the more careful. Media entertainment, again, there are a lot of ways. Often we find that some movies available or talk show is available free, of course, so why should I pay for that? It's a lure. It's actually, you know, putting a kind of a bait for us to get us into this kind of site. And when we are watching the movie or the talk show, they're actually entering our system and trying to take control of our system. So these are some of the common things which are happening. And they may be also part of the cyber winter, but post-COVID, that is since the pandemic has broken out, it's actually creating a lot of these issues. Let's be a little more careful on that. Airports, they're not actually trying to disturb. At least I have not come across civilian aircraft being disturbed in flight. But yes, they're trying to play around with military aircraft. Some of the best in the world have crashed for no reason. And civilian aircrafts, the tactic used is to make the takeoff and landing of the aircraft difficult. Suddenly you find a lot of miniature drones entering the runway or disturbing the takeoff and landing of the aircraft. And in such situation, the air traffic controller does not allow the aircraft to, you know, fly in or fly out. And there'll be delays. There can be a lot of economic losses because of that. And this is one of the tactics they are repeatedly using in some of the airports in Europe. So technically speaking, can they bring down a civilian aircraft? Yes, they can. Even with 30 drones, you can actually jam an engine of a civilian aircraft and bring it down anytime. But fortunately, they're not going to that level. And schools, one more threat is please sensitize children on fake profiles which try to show they are also a child of the same age and they are in a very happy family sitting in some very nice country. They become very close to each other. And suddenly you find a boy who or girl who is very active in class, very good at academics, suddenly becoming very insecure, losing interest in studies, and very scared of everything. So when this kind of telltale signs come in, please look out. He may be a victim of child abuse on internet. Often it's cyber criminals who have a very perverted mind who get into this kind of child abuse. And very recently we helped arrest of one of the person. He's 70 years old and he was in Italy. And he has actually, sorry to say that, but he has abused around 40,000 children across the world. And he used this fake profile, trying to convince the child that he is also the same age and they can be very good friends, gain their confidence, and know their address, know their family members. And when family members are there at home or not at home, all these things he used to do it very discreetly. And somewhere tempt the children to kind of expose themselves or kind of get involved in unnatural acts, or even allow this person physically to enter their home and abuse the child physically. So this one more we got to sensitize. Now, blocking access to technology is not an answer. I find there's an argument which says, why should we allow children to use web, or why should we allow them to use, you know, phone at all? No, that's actually a technology enabler, but we got to take the responsibility of telling them how to do it and what they should be little conscious about it. And children are very, very more alert than adults. That's my experience also, because often when I try to explain to people what they should do, what they should not do, it's always a reaction that we know everything. But it's not so much as far as children are concerned. So we got to be very careful. So that's one more suggestion on where we can try to help our children. And we went into this, and a lot of this are there. And cyber winter, unfortunately, we are in cyber winter. It can affect anybody, any country. And they're making full use of the pandemic and trying to create this kind of situation. So don't panic if something really happens. Trust the cyber police. Bring everything where you have the slightest ambiguity to the notice of the cyber police. And then actually you can, allow them to take it forward. IoT and the cloud attacks is basically where increase in attacks are happening. Almost 61% of organizations have experienced IoT-based attacks. And Capital One was probably one of the largest financial company in America to experience a data breach, and almost information about 11 crore customers was revealed and taken to by the misused by the cyber criminals. And later on they found that it was not just Capital One. There were almost 30 organizations which are affected in this incident. All this happened because there was a misconfiguration in the cloud. So it was a Amazon Web Services cloud, and somebody had done a mistake in configuration, and the cyber criminals used that mistake to create this problem for 31 organizations. And we are looking at almost like 1460 crore IoT devices to be functional in about a year. And we're also looking at a 42% growth in annual business mobile traffic. So all these things are there. So we got to actually a little bit more careful. More we are on digital space, more challenges we are going to face. And the cost of security has increased by 25% because the incidents are increasing, the complexity is increasing, the cost of security is also increasing. And that is where some of the organizations are turning away. They feel that why should we spend so much money? We are very secure. Now we can't do that because we got to be more careful and more investing on cyber security. Only then we can be in a position to identify whatever is the upcoming attacks and also defend ourselves. So presently I'll be talking in the next coming slides about 5 to 6 of them, opportunities there. Anybody can join cyber industry, can be a degree student, can be a technical student, can be a master degree, or it could be even MSc, MBA kind of professionals. Anybody can join this. You can join in any of the streams. You can be in core operations, or you could be from the strategy and legal side. So what exactly is required as a skill profile? My friend will be going into detail, but I'll be just sharing from the industry perspective. Three things. One is how quickly you can detect a cyber attack, how quickly you can restore a cyber attack, and what is the quick response time you can provide, even if you notice there's an attempt or a cyber attempt. Now, two type of roles are available. One is strategic, where non-technical people and people from management, science, and law background can work. Operations is where your core technology skills are being used. And both overlap at some point of time, and if you really want to learn about operations, you can learn it. It's not so difficult, not so much of code writing there, but you got to learn a lot of tools there and technologies. And otherwise, you can continue to contribute to the organization, even contribute to the creation of cyber security standards for the industry. It's an evolving space right now, so it's somewhere we got to be a little proactive there. And other thing is cost of cyber attack. If it's one of the questions asked, if you are an aspirant for working in cyber industry, you should know what is the way to calculate a cyber attack, because I shared some numbers earlier, how many trillion we lost, how much Indians have lost and all this. How do you calculate that? That you see on your slide. Take the daily cost of attack, multiply with the number of days you spend to detect and fix an attack, and what is the proportion of attacks. So when I said type, we have four types. One is very serious attack. Second is a medium scale attack. Third is a minor scale attack. And fourth is an attack where no loss really happened. Then multiply that with the number of attacks, and you get the cost per cyber attack. Now this can vary from organization to organization, but often people fail in providing this calculation methodology. And if you're still looking at having your own startup or consulting or even doing an academic project, you could do in any of these steps to cybersecurity. And Gajendra will actually be explaining the academic opportunities in detail. So this one more area where institutions can work with industries. So this is where other things is where some key technologies. This is primarily for people who are in technical stream. If you can know how to use artificial intelligence, then that can be used to reduce the impact of each cyber breach. Then if you know the SOIR, then that can be used for very precise identification of any cyber attack, and also reduce the damage of the cyber attack, and also reduce the cost of recovery. Next generation fiber firewall, this is primarily for people who are working in the field of network or want to build a very good career in cyber security related networks, then next generation firewall is there. What I marked in red is currently these technologies are being used, but we find a limitation there when it's becoming more and more complex. So if at all you're in these kind of technologies, 4, 5, and 6, try to move into the new skills, and you can continue to grow in the industry as well as the organization. This one more area where you can try to build up skills, we call it as a security incident and event management. Earlier it was incident management, then it became security event management. So currently we're talking about security incident and event management. So there are a lot of branches out there, And in the interest of time, I'm actually, you know, allowing you to go through the slide, and wherever you are very particular about knowing something, then probably you can reach out to KSTA, and they could probably organize a workshop on SIEM and related technologies for cyber security. So with this, I would like to thank all of you, and any questions, I'll be happy to answer. I find some questions coming in here, and one of the questions that said is, do you require a competent authority to govern what permissions the applications request? Yes, there are guidelines from CERT for India, and that's a nodal organization which is actually helping fight cybercrime in India. And we have this kind of collaboration with other CERT. Thanks to the initiative of Prime Minister, this cross-country collaboration in cybersecurity and research and development is happening. And that's basically where we are growing there. So that's one more area where you can look at. And any other questions?
Sir, there is one more question.
Yeah.
Any method or application to identify that the smartphone or device is under attack?
I think I'd try to answer that. There are some of the pointers there. Look at memory usage, look at your data usage, look at any abnormal functioning of the system or the phone. It can be kind of, you know, the people complaining your voice is very low, and still they hear somebody else when they're talking to you, or you may be repeatedly getting calls from unknown numbers. And this I get it, because I get calls at all odd hours in the night. Now, it's not that people want to wake me up, but if you're getting calls from really unknown numbers, particularly which are not Indian number, and even if it's outside number, you don't know which country they're calling from, please don't receive the call. Please don't receive the call. Moment you receive the call, you show your number is an active number, and any active number comes at a very premium pricing in cyber world. So they'll be randomly calling, and whenever people say hello, the call gets cut off. And we think it's a network problem. We try to call back, and you get an answer that this phone number does not exist. So please don't receive call. Particularly if it's a no number call, please complain immediately to DOT. It could be a VOIP call which is being misused by somebody. Or if it is coming from an unknown country, some country you don't even know, there's no reason to take that call. You can just ignore that. Any other questions?
Thank you very much, sir. Sir, there is one more question. Smartphone doesn't support the unsecured applications by scanning them. So such smartphones, can you tell me something about that smartphone, sir?
I think we'll allow Gajendra to take over on that, because he'll be explaining what really happens in some of these things from the technical perspective. So I'll, in the interest of time, I'll request Gajendra to answer that when he gets the chance of answering questions.
Sir?
Yes, please.
Thank you very much for a very informative and insightful talk on cybersecurity. I'm sure participants would have got enough to broaden their horizon in cybersecurity. I hope not many cyber warriors will develop with your good talk. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Presenter is an academician, Dr. Gajendra Deshpande, who holds Masters in Computer Science and Engineering. He is working as an assistant professor at the Department of Computer Science and Engineering, KLS, Gokhale Institute of Technology, Belagavi. He holds a postgraduate diploma in cyber law and cyber forensics from National University of National Law University, Bangalore. He has more than 12 years of teaching experience. He is a very well accomplished academician. He has presented papers in different countries like UK and USA and France. With this very brief introduction, I welcome Dr. Gajendra Deshpande to take over the cyber platform for his talk. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Am I audible?
Yes, audible and visible, sir.
Yes. My slides are visible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Make the presentation proceeding, sir.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Okay. So I would like to thank Ramesh sir from KSTA and Udesh sir for giving me an opportunity to speak at such a prestigious platform and share whatever I know few things about cybersecurity. So today I will be speaking about cybersecurity technologies and academic opportunities. So my talk will be mostly theoretical and what are some of the research opportunities available and where some courses related to cybersecurity, cyber law and cyber forensics are available. So it will be useful to the participants if they want to make a career, if they want to learn something related to cybersecurity or cyber law. So today I will be discussing about technologies, security goals, confidentiality, authentication, then the deception technology, then academic opportunities available, then how you can start your own community related to security. So starting with security goals, basically theoretically there will be six security goals. So first one is confidentiality, then authentication, then accountability and non-repudiation, then integrity, then access control and availability. So when we say confidentiality, it means only the receiver or the user is able to understand the contents of the message. So there are many techniques which can be used to implement confidentiality. So one of them is encryption. So we will discuss encryption in the next slide. The next is authentication. So authentication is the identity of the individuals involved, which can be confirmed. So again, there are many technologies, many ways where you can implement authentication. Then accountability and non-repudiation. So non-repudiation is something, let's assume that I have sent a message on a WhatsApp. When I send a message on WhatsApp, you see some green tick mark. So when I send a message and you have read it, then I cannot deny that I have not sent a message. Yeah. Then integrity is the assurance that the information has not been altered, it has not been modified. Then access control is the security measure that permits the access to the various resources by the user or a process. Again, let's take the example of WhatsApp. So in WhatsApp, you can make some settings. For example, there are two main roles. One is admin only and user only. So if admin of the group, if he makes the group as admin only, then only he can send the message. others can only read the message. So access control is very, very important. It basically defines in an organization who has access to what. Let's say, for example, again, there is a website and this website belongs to a very large organization. So website of a large organization cannot have a single administrator. So it can have multiple administrators at multiple levels. So at each level, you need to define the access roles. Let's say, for example, editor. So if there's an editor role, what he will be able to do? He may be only be able to view the web page and edit the web page. He may not be able to make changes to the layout of the web page. If there's an administrator, then he can add or remove the users. And he will be able to alter the layout of the web page. So like that, there will be different users. And at each level, there will be different access controls. The next one is availability. So availability is the ensuring that the required services are accessible to the users. Now, when we say availability, generally it's a perception that availability is defined 24/7 or 365 days. But it's not actually true. It depends on the application. If it is a website, yes, we can assume that it should be available 24/7 or 365 days. But when we say availability, it is defined in terms of accessibility. Let me take one more example. Now, my working hours are generally defined as 8 hours. If I'm available for all 8 hours, then my availability is set as 100%. But if I'm available for 6 hours, then my availability is set as 75%. So here on my job, I'm not expected to be on the job 24 hours. So when I say availability, it is clear that it depends on the application. It depends on the application's requirement. Then when we go to the next concept, that is confidentiality. So encryption is the one technique which ensures confidentiality is implemented in your application. Now, what is encryption basically? It converts the plain text into a ciphertext using a mathematical formula. Using mathematical formula is very important whenever you are converting from plain text to ciphertext. Now, there is another concept, decryption, which converts your ciphertext to. So plain text is in human readable form, whereas ciphertext is not in human readable form. So whenever we are sending the information, you can convert it into ciphertext and send it to the receiver. So at the receiver side, the receiver will decrypt the message using the keys. Now, cryptography techniques can be divided into two types. So one is symmetric key cryptography, and second one is asymmetric key cryptography. When we say symmetric key cryptography, we are going to use a single key for encryption as well as decryption. And when I say asymmetric key cryptography, we are going to use two different keys, one for encryption and another one for decryption. Now you can see a diagram here. It explains how encryption decryption process works. Now what sender does is, he is going to use the encryption module on the plain text. So it will be converted to the ciphertext and it will be sent to the receiver. On the receiver side, receiver is going to use decryption module on the ciphertext and he will get the plain text back. Now, when I say symmetric key cryptography, so I have already said same key will be used both for encryption as well as decryption. Now, you can see in the diagram, there is a plain text which will be encrypted. In the middle, you can see one block. You can see some junk characters there, which are not in human understandable form. So that's an example for cipher text. And on the receiver side, he's going to use the decryption key. So in this case, he's going to use the same secret key, which is shared by the sender. So when he decrypts, he will get the plain text back. So some examples of symmetric key cryptography are advanced encryption standards can be used, or DES can be used, which are most widely used symmetric key cryptography algorithms. The next is the asymmetric key cryptography. So here different keys are used for encryption and decryption. Now you can see here again, we have the same modules such as plain text, then ciphertext, and again plain text at the receiver. Now, what sender does here is he's going to use the receiver's public key to encrypt the plain text before sending it to the receiver. Now, on the receiver side, so receiver is going to use his private key to decrypt the information. Okay, so you can see here there are two different keys are used. One for encryption, public key is used, and second one is a private key, which is used for decryption. So some algorithms like RSA algorithm uses asymmetric key cryptography. Apart from that, there are some other cryptographic algorithms which use asymmetric key cryptography. Now, this is an interesting concept here with respect to encryption algorithms. This is known as homomorphic encryption. So basically what we do in homomorphic encryption is we perform some computations on ciphertext. Okay. It is very important to explore the properties of or to explore the homomorphic properties of encryption algorithms, because that allows us to do some computations without decrypting it. So in this way, we can ensure the privacy of data. Now this will be useful if you want to use the computing power of some device, and maybe that device is compromised. So in that case, if you decrypt the message on the compromised device, it will be revealed to the attacker. So in that case, you can use homomorphic encryption, where even you will be able to use the computing capability of a compromised device to do some computations. Now let's look at this diagram and let's try to understand how this works. Now here we have two plain texts. So plain text 1 and plain text 2. When we encrypt plain text P1, we will get plain text EP1. We will get encrypted text EP1. When we encrypt plain text P2, we will get encrypted text EP2. Now, when I say homomorphic properties, some cryptographic algorithms have been classified as additive and some have been classified as multiplicative. And some are both. That is, you can perform arbitrary computations. So, RSA algorithm is multiplicative homomorphic encryption property supported by RSA algorithm. So that means you can take two encrypted texts and perform multiplication operation on them. Now these cryptographic algorithms such as RSA, which support either additive property or multiplicative property are known as partial homomorphic encryption techniques, but there are some algorithms such as Gentry's crypto systems which support arbitrary computations on the encrypted data. Now, once you perform computations on encrypted data, and you will get a result. When we decrypt the result, it will be same as the result of operations performed on the plain text. So on the right hand side, I have given one example. So let's assume two plain text P1 as 5 and P2 as 10. And just for our understanding purpose, I'm going to assume that when I encrypt P1, I'm going to get its encrypted version as 50. Similarly, when I encrypt P2, I'm going to get its encrypted version as 100. Now, when I perform operations, note here that I'm not adding 5 and 10, or I'm not multiplying 5 and 10. Instead, I'm adding 50 and 100. And also, I'm multiplying 50 and 100. So when I add, I'm going to get result as 150 and 5000. Now when I decrypt these results, I'm going to get the result as 15 and 50, which are same as you have, as if you have performed operations on the P1 and P2. So this is the advantage of homomorphic encryption. So there are lots of opportunities in homomorphic encryption. Still, many properties have to be explored of cryptographic algorithms. And one more problem with respect to homomorphic encryption is they are very compute intensive. So if we try to apply homomorphic encryption to IoT, that is Internet of Things, where resources are limited, so your homomorphic encryption operations may consume all of the resources, or they may not be sufficient. So in that case, you may have to work on some techniques which can help in reducing the intensity of computation. So this is a small example. Here we have used RSA algorithm. And you can see the first number is 22 and second number is 87. Both are in plain text. When we encrypted 22 and 87, we have got some numbers here. That is 2027889. So that's the encrypted number of 22. Similarly, the next number is encrypted number of 87. Then when we perform multiplication on these two encrypted numbers, we have got some large number here. And when you decrypt it, we are getting 1914, which is nothing but the multiplication of 22 and 87. So the advantage of homomorphic encryption nowadays is, or the application which we can think is, you can also use it in machine learning. So machine learning uses a lot of data. So we train our model using machine learning algorithms on the plain data. So what you can explore is, can we apply these homomorphic encryption techniques and encrypt the data set and then train the model? So we need to explore such opportunities, and that area is known as privacy preserving machine learning. Now next, when we come to authentication, again there are many techniques with respect to authentication. So the simplest one is using passwords. So everyone uses passwords, but when you use passwords, you need to use some guidelines. So you should ensure that your password consists of uppercase letters, lowercase letters, it consists of some special characters, it should not be from the dictionary. So it should be a combination of alphanumeric characters basically. So using strong password, you can ensure up to certain level of protection. Now there is a site known as haveibeenpwned.com. So here you can type your email address, and if you click on this pwned button, it will show whether your password is already compromised. So what hackers do is they hack these databases. Maybe let's assume that they have hacked the database of Hotmail. So they have a list of passwords associated with many accounts. When they get this, they will sell it on the dark web. So in that case, you can check whether your email account's password has been compromised, whether it has been leaked. So this site will help you, haveibeenpwned.com. So you can use this site. Now you can also use this site to check whether the password also has been compromised. So let's say, for example, you want to reset a password. Again, you can come to this site, you can type your password here, and it will show whether that password has been already in the dark web or it is already been there in haveibeenpwned database. But it doesn't mean that if it doesn't find your password on this site, it doesn't mean that your password is secure. Only thing what we can say here is it has not yet been updated on HIBP website. Now to deal with the problems of password, then two-factor authentication techniques have been introduced. Now again, when we say two-factor authentication, there is one more additional layer of say, for example, when you log into your email account, when you enter your password, you will get an OTP on your mobile phone. Sometimes you may get OTP, or it will ask you to click on yes button on your mobile phone. So again, there are various techniques. Now to improve the effectiveness of two-factor authentication, what companies are doing is they are setting the validity of two-factor authentication for some time. Maybe the OTP is sent to you on your mobile phone, it will be valid for say 2 minutes or 1 minute, like that. But again, attackers have proven that that is not safe. Now the next technique is keystroke dynamics. This is a new area where we can use the keystroke dynamics to identify or to authenticate particular user account. So how this works is has a different typing speed. So whenever he presses a key on the keyboard, he takes some time. Whenever he releases a key on some keyboard, again it's going to take some time. So there is a delay between the key press and the key release. So this delay may be varying from person to person. So this delay varies from person to person. So when I type a sentence, when a person X types a sentence, so keystroke dynamics will be different for person X, keystroke dynamic will be different for person Y. So we can use keystroke dynamics again to authenticate a person. But there is a problem with respect to that. If the person is the keystroke dynamics will be different for a single person at different types in a day. So keystroke dynamics for person X will be different in the morning, it will be different in the afternoon, it will be different in the evening. There's a possibility. Apart from that, there are other factors affects the keystroke dynamics. If the person is very active, if he is feeling very active, then again the Keystone Dynamics will be. If he is tired, then again the. So what commercial is there? Such scenarios to make their product successful. Now, with respect to integrity, no technique or one of the technique which can be used is the digital signature. Now, again, with respect to our cryptography, public key cryptography, there are two parties here, sender and receiver. Now, note here that when we are sending the information using a digital signature, we are going to send the information in plain text form. We are not going to send the information in cipher text form. So here on plain text, some hash algorithms will be applied. So when you apply hash algorithm, it will generate a message digest. Now note here that this message digest will be encrypted, okay, using a asymmetric cryptographic algorithm. So in this case, we can assume that we may use RSA algorithm. So note here, plain text is not encrypted, your message digest is encrypted, okay, and your plain text together with message digest will be sent to the receiver. Now what receiver will do is, he will decrypt the message digest and he will apply the same hash algorithm which sender has used on the plain text. He will get a message digest again. Now there are two message digests at the receiver side, so both must match. If both match, then only we can say that message has not been altered. If you get a different digest, if two message digests don't match, then we can say that your message has been altered. Okay. So this is about digital signature, but this is one of the techniques. So now again, digital signature can also be used for authentication purpose. Now this is one more topic, that is known as deception. So in deception, what we do is we use hackers' methods as a security mechanism. So if hackers use phishing as a method, then we use the same technique to deal with the phishers. So it's a military tactic used by both attackers as well as defenders. Now you can see in the diagram how it works. So we have a benign user and we have a malicious user. Now, benign user and malicious user, they access the common interface. That is, they access the same user interface. But if the system comes to know that, okay, this particular user is authorized, then it will redirect him to real system. But if the system on the server, if it comes to know that if the person is unauthorized, then it will not redirect him to real system, instead it will redirect him to deceptive system. There are two types of deceptions. One is active deception and second one is passive deception. In active deception, what happens is inaccurate information will be intentionally provided to the hackers. And in passive deception, what happens? Incomplete information will be provided. So in order to access the complete information, they will fall to the trap. Now client side deception like phishing can be used by hackers. So the similar technique on server side deception can be used by security providers. So to have a better deception, you can also combine active deception as well as passive deception. Now, honeypots, when we say the evolution of deception technology, so in 1998, first honeypots were introduced. Then in 2000, honey nets came, then honey tokens, then honeypot 2.0, then finally the deception technology in 2016. Now, what is a honeypot? Basically, it's a data which has the features of legitimate data, and generally it's an isolated system. When the attacker tries to access this isolated system, his activity will be monitored and reported. Then similarly, with respect to honey nets, it's a network of honeypots. So instead of single honeypot, in a network, multiple honeypots can be set up. Then there is honey token. So honey token is a small information which you can add it to the legitimate data. So when somebody steals your data, this honey token will send notification to the owner of the data saying that so-and-so information has been stolen and how it was leaked. So deception technology has got some advantages, like it has got increased accuracy, then it results into minimal investment, and it's also future ready. You can also use it with new technology. So using deception, we may not be able to prevent the attacks completely, but it gives us some time. It gives us some information saying that, okay, so-and-so attack is happening, we need to take action. So it gives us the extra time to deal with the attacks. So this was the system which we had worked. Now you can see here in this diagram, there are three tiers. One is the presentation tier, then the business tier, then the data tier. In presentation tier, we have the user interface. Then you, whatever inputs you supply in the presentation tier, that will be processed in the business tier, that is on the web server. And the actual data is stored on the data tier. Now you can see on the data tier, we have three types of data. One is the XML document. It can be even normal RDBMS database, such as MySQL or Oracle, which stores the actual data. Then we have one more database which stores the fake data, but this fake data looks like real data. Then there are some custom error messages which are also stored on data tier. You need to have these custom error messages. So what will happen if you don't have custom error messages? I will explain shortly. Now when we come to again presentation tier, so the expected valid inputs are your email IDs, mobile numbers, or any alphanumeric words, which can be treated as legitimate inputs. What attackers do is they supply some malicious inputs. So you can see the malicious, some examples of malicious inputs are mentioned in the green color. Now, for example, observe the first two. So what is written here is 1 or 1 equal to 1 or user or A equal to A. Now to the SQL query or to the XPath query in XML, if we append this malicious input, no matter what is your input on the left hand side, it will always, it's going to result into true because of OR Boolean operator. So how OR works is either of one should be true. So here in this case, the left hand side input may be false, but the right hand side input will always result into true. So this is how they gain access to your database. So that's why here, whenever you develop the application, it becomes very important to implement input validation. If you don't perform input validation properly, then you are giving access to the database, to the hackers. Then apart from malicious input, there's something known as invalid inputs. So the examples of invalid inputs are very large input string, or the string with special characters, or string formatted with a different character set. So what these will do is, these will generate the error messages. So when error messages are displayed, even your error messages are going to disclose some technical information. Say for example, what is the operating system of the server? What is the version of the server? So this information is very, very important for the hacker. Because if he comes to know about the operating system and its version, he is aware of the vulnerabilities present in that version. So he can use those vulnerabilities to perform more attacks and gain the access. So that's why to avoid this, you need to implement custom error messages. So when you use custom error messages, you are not going to disclose the system information. So you should design the custom error messages in such a way that it should not disclose any system information, such as operating system version, browser information. Now you can see here, this was a small application developed by us. So here we have two files. One is data.xml where the legitimate data is stored. Then we have one more fake data.xml where the fake data which looks similar to legitimate data is being stored. Now this is the initial user interface. Yes. Now when you enter the legitimate user input, when you enter the legitimate username and when you enter legitimate password, it will gain access to the real data or legitimate database. But the interface is same here. Now you can see here, instead of legitimate user inputs, malicious input has been given as the input in the login form. So in that case, it has not denied the access. Instead, it has revealed some data. But if you observe it, it has revealed the fake data. It has not revealed the original data. So now what attacker can do is, he can use this information and he can log into that system. But you can see here, it says fake login successful. That means it has redirected the attacker to fake system. Your real system is safe. So this is a deception implemented. This is a deception technique implemented. So what we had done is, we had done a very simple thing here. Same interface was provided for both legitimate users and attackers. So when system detected that the login attempt was by attacker, it had redirected them to fake resources. So in order to protect the real resources. And you can also see here, whenever user is performing the attack, or whenever user performing any activity related to the interface, that has been logged. And this log information can be used for further analysis. Now, these are about the technologies. So I have covered only few things, but a lot of opportunities are available if you want to explore more on these technologies. Now coming to the academic opportunities. So NITK Suratkalp offers master's degree in information security. So it's a full-time 2-year course. So GATE is the first thing. You need to qualify in GATE exam. So once you qualify in GATE exam, you will be eligible to write their entrance test again. They will take interview, and if you are qualified, they will offer you this course. So more information can be provided on the website. So you can visit this website to get the more information. The next is post-graduation diploma in cyber law and cyber forensics. So it is offered by National Law School of India University. So it's a distance learning course, 1 year course. So the course structure is you need to clear 4 theory courses and 1 dissertation. So dissertation is very important as per the institute. And if you look at the dissertation topics, they are really good, they are really advanced. So you need to submit a dissertation of around 80 to 100 pages. To them, they will conduct a Viva. Then if you have cleared all theory courses and if you have cleared dissertation, they will award you a PhD diploma. Then why you need to go for post-graduation diploma in cyber laws is law has a different perspective of technology. Let's say, for example, we have discussed about cryptography. So in cryptography, many algorithms are there. Like RSA algorithm is there, LGAML encryption is there, Diffie-Hellman key exchange is there, then elliptic curve cryptography is there. Then also there are some cryptographic algorithms related to quantum cryptography are there. And when we come to elliptic curve cryptography, there are numerous curves which offer different level of security. But the problem here is not all cryptographic algorithms are recognized by law. Not all curves with respect to elliptic curve cryptography are not recognized by law. So it is very important for a person to understand which is supported by law and which is not supported by law. Because if you implement an algorithm, if you implement a cryptographic algorithm, which is not supported by law, then there will not be any remedy available to you if you implement a cryptographic algorithm which is not supported by law. So that's why you need to check whether law supports a particular algorithm, whether it supports a particular technology, whether it supports the particular way of implementation. And with respect to cyber forensics, is very, again, important topic. In cybersecurity, we basically deal with the protection of the infrastructure. But cyber forensics comes into picture when some attack happens. So the investigation starts. So here, lots of tools are available with respect to cyber forensics. So cyber forensics is not only about using the tools. It is also about following right procedure for collecting the digital evidence. It is also about right procedure of documenting the evidence. Because if you don't follow the evidence, if you don't follow the procedure prescribed by law in collecting the evidence, then you cannot submit that evidence in the court. Court will not accept it. And whenever you go to a crime scene, you need to collect the data. Say, for example, you need to collect the data from a computer. So if the computer is on, you need to collect the system. You need to collect the data from the system, which is in on state. You should not turn it off. If the system is off, you should not turn it on. So you should record the present state of the system. Okay. And you should ensure that in any case, the collected evidence is not altered. So you will learn such things in this particular course. Now there is one more course, Master of Cyber Law and Information Security. This is offered by National Law Institute, University Bhopal. It's a full-time 2-year course. So again, in this course, there are theory courses, dissertation plus internship are there. You need to write a national level entrance test for it. So due to COVID pandemic, they have extended the application until further notice. So if anybody is interested, they can still apply. But you need to write the entrance test and clear the interview to get the admission. This is a very interesting course. It has a very good combination of law and information security subjects. So a lot of technology subjects have been included here in this particular course. The next, again, the same university also offers PhD in cyber law and information security. So it is offered in both full-time as well as part-time mode. So again, the procedure is same. You need to clear the written test as well as the interview. So they have mentioned that course duration is 2 years, but still we need to verify it once again. So again, applications are open. So to this program, even people from technology background, if you have done a master's in technology, computer science or information science, you are eligible. MSc cybersecurity or cyber forensics are also eligible for this program. Of course, law graduates are eligible by default. Then this is another course, post-graduation diploma in cyber law. This is offered by Nalsar University of Hyderabad. Again, it's a 1 year distance learning course. So here you need to clear just 4 theory courses and they will award you the post-graduation diploma. Now, if you observe the course content, which is offered by NLS Bangalore and Nalsar University, it is a bit different. So here they deal with electronic contracts and e-taxations. So you can see the course content of both the courses, whichever is relevant to you, you can go for that course, or one by one, both the courses, that's also fine. Now, Nalsar University also offers some other interesting courses related to defense laws, space laws, telecommunication laws. So 2 year Master of Arts courses are offered in distance mode. Again, applications are open. Yeah. Now, few colleges in VTU also offer 2 year M.Tech program in cyber forensics and information security. So mostly few colleges in Bangalore, they offer. I'm not sure, or I'm not aware of which colleges are offering master's program related to this. But if you visit VTU site, you will get the details about this course, syllabus, scheme, everything you will get. Again, it's a 2 years course. So you need to clear theory exams plus labs, seminars, internship and project work. You need to complete in order to get this degree. Now, apart from this, some institutes offers honors and minors program in cybersecurity. So apart from your regular coursework, if you are a UG student in some courses, mostly autonomous colleges, they offer honors and minors program in cybersecurity. So you need to earn extra credits. So in our institute, you need to earn extra 18 credits in order to get the honors in cybersecurity. So the course structure here will be 3 theory courses and 2 online MOOC courses you need to complete. So this program will vary from institute to institute. So there are many institutes which offer in that way. Apart from that, many institutes will also have a academic alliance with cybersecurity training companies like EC Council. So through that, they offer training programs to their students. Now, let's assume that you don't have any of this. So you are just a student studying in your college, maybe technology college. It can be any college, say engineering college or BCA college, MCA college or MSc college. There will be few professors. There will be few professors who will be working on cybersecurity fields. So you contact them and try to work with them. Definitely they will be having some ideas related to cybersecurity. So you can work in collaboration with them and you can publish papers. Apart from that, reputed institutions like IITs and TIFR, like and some other institutes, they invite applications from students every year for internship. You can apply there, and if your interest and if your professor's interest match, then you can join for internship there. And if you are a professional, you can join meetup groups in your cities. If your city doesn't have a meetup group, then you can think of starting your own meetup group. So especially in metro cities, actually there is no problem at all. You will find a lot of meetup groups. You can just go to meetup.com and search for your group. You will get a lot of groups there and you can join. Then you can also collaborate with people who have similar interests. So that will happen when you join these meetup groups and when you become a member of a professional chapter. Now, if you want to start your own community, that is a meetup group on Meetup maybe, so you can consider this, the Open Web Application Security Project, OWASP. So it is an international body which basically works on top 10 web vulnerabilities. So there are 177 groups worldwide. If you want to start your own chapter, you can approach them. There is no cost at all. But the only requirement is surrounding 80 kilometers, there should not be another OWSP chapter. So that's the restriction they have. Otherwise, they will provide you the chapter. Make a team and start a chapter. They will also provide you the funding. So there are lots of events happening with respect to OWSP. Apart from chapters, if you, let's assume that you don't want to start a chapter, you have a project idea related to web application security, then you can also start a project. So chapter and projects both are treated differently. You can apply for OWSP project there and get their approval. Then null chapters. So this is the largest open source community in India related to security. So it has got around 14 chapters. So many times it also happens that null and other professional security chapters, they work together. So you can decide, if you are interested, then you can think of starting a chapter. Now, apart from this, if you are a student, then every year there's a competition conducted by Google. That is known as GSOC, Google Summer of Code. So in that also, many security organizations, including OWSP, they have their projects. So you can apply to their projects and you can complete the summer internship with GSOC. So likewise, many opportunities are available. So thank you for providing me an opportunity. So whatever little information I had shared with you. Thank you, KSTA, for providing me an opportunity. I think there are some questions here.
Sir, one question.
Hi, sir.
To whom we can call ethical hackers?
No, sorry.
To whom we can call ethical hackers?
Ethical hackers. Those who don't have the intention to harm anyone. So you can call them as ethical hackers. Earlier, actually, hackers term nowadays has been misused. Actually, hackers is not a correct term. Those who are harming it, they should be called as crackers, not hackers. So if there's a problem and if you are providing a solution to it, right? So if there's a device, it is not working, if you are making it to work, then you can consider it as a hacker. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. I think the importance of hacker you have already covered.
Yeah.
And there is one more question about security of team. I think Uday Shankar sir can answer this.
Sorry?
The security regarding DEM application.
Your voice is breaking.
The security on DEM application. PHIM, sir, BIM application.
Unable to hear you. Can I just share the one on chat?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
BIM application, recently there was some news reported by one of the groups in London that BIM was insecure and there's a lot of user data that was available on the dark web. But that's not actually been authenticated. Sometimes we get false starts which are not always true. So apart from this one group, which is reported in London, I have not seen this reported in any other forum. So if at all there has been an issue, then probably the government of India would have taken care of the security for this BIM application. But as far as I know, it's a very secure application and a lot of people are using it.
Thank you very much, sir.
And if there are
sir.
Faculty from the colleges on the webinar, I have a suggestion. Please try to build a center of excellence in your college for cybersecurity that will attract collaboration from industry, and also you can probably look at research and development in the school as well. Thank you.
I would like to thank Dr. Gajendra for a wonderful talk. I'm sure students have got enough information to broaden the horizon of their knowledge in cybersecurity. In spite, Dr. Uday Shankar Puranik is a very busy person. In spite of his very busy schedule, he gave us time slot to fix up his cybersecurity webinar. We are very grateful to you, sir. And thanks to all the participants for their patience. We have sat through two talks for 2 hours. We wish to conduct many more webinars like this. You can give us suggestion. If you want to give any suggestion, please mail us at ksta.gok@gmail.com. We'd like to improve our webinars in future as well. Thank you very much, sir. Regarding Center of Excellence, Karnataka Science and Technology Department has established one Center of Excellence in IISc campus. KSCST, Karnataka Council for Science and Technology, is the nodal agency who is looking after this cybersecurity center. Thank you. And I would also like to thank Professor Shantanu Das, who has been with us since morning. He has been helping us in organizing webinars related to COVID, and also for this webinar he has given his support. Thank you very much, Professor Shantanu. Words from Shantanu Das.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Uday Shankar Puranik ji. We know how busy you are, and we are very lucky, along with our so many participants, that we have come across to deliver such a wonderful talk, along with Gajendra Deshpande ji. And I thank wholeheartedly KSTA, Dr. Ramesh, AM sir, CEO, and Ayyappan sir, the chairman of KSTA, who has recently joined. And under their guidance, along with Vishadipuram group, we have organized nearly 4 or 5 national webinars, and this is the 5th one jointly hosted. So we hope so, like this webinars we can host and we can hear and make people knowledgeable about the things which they know but they are ignorant about. So thank you, one and all, sir.
Very much.
Thank you so much for your kind acceptance and jointly hosting the event with us, sir. Dr. Ramesh, sir. Thank you so much.
So once again, thanks to all the participants. If you have any suggestion, please share with us on our email, ksta.gok@gmail.com. Thank you very much.